I am a poet. That's why I'm interesting. That's why I like writing about myself. Sometimes I write about other things, but only for the sake of creating poetry. Alexander Pushkin, let me introduce myself. My name is Vladimir Mayakovsky, and I am probably the one person who really misses you. Those were quotations from one of Mayakovsky's poems. He was born on the 7th of July, 1894, or it might have been 1893. His mother's memory and his father's service record never did tally. But certainly it wasn't before 1893, when he was brought into this world in the village of Baghdadi, in the Kutais district of Georgia. His father, Vladimir Konstantinovich, was a forest warden. His mother's name was Alexandra Alexeyevna. He had two sisters, Luda and Olya. He didn't know of any other relatives. He probably didn't have any. Mayakovsky's sister, Luda, was to write in her memoirs,
"Now these rooms are a shrine. They appear to be too dark, but that is because the trees outside have grown so large. We all liked Georgia and its people. We all spoke Georgian, but we were careful to preserve the Russian language, the traditions and customs of our ancestors."
The family moved from Baghdadi to Kutais. Mayakovsky went to school. He was brilliant, the best pupil with the best marks. He liked fiction, especially Jules Verne. The man in this photograph, the man with the beard, considered him to be an artist and gave him free lessons. In 1904, Mayakovsky was reading a lot. It didn't matter what. It stimulated him. The postcards portraying giant liners invigorated him. He used to enlarge them and make copies. 1905, the year of the first Russian Revolution. His sister came to visit him from Moscow. She was excited about the whole thing. She secretly showed him some subversive documents. He was enthralled. Revolution. There were poems. Poems and revolution became indivisible in his mind. His father died. He had cut his finger and picked up an infection. After the funeral, the family had only 3 rubles to their name. They moved to Moscow. It's hard to imagine why, since they had no friends or relatives there. They rented a flat on Bronnaya Street. They had nothing to eat. He and his two sisters went to school while their mother was forced to let out rooms, a bed for the night, and a meal. They were dreadful rooms. The only tenants they could get were poor students, socialists. They were broke. Mayakovsky tried his hand as an artist. His fifth school, and he was in the fourth form. His marks were disastrous. During lessons, he was reading other things under his desk. He'd gone off fiction now, preferring philosophy. Above all, he was fascinated by Marxism, especially Two Tactics by Lenin. The book had no margins. He loved it. It made him feel like a revolutionary. Aesthetic rules of maximum economy. Mayakovsky's mother was to write in her memoirs,
"He went to school, but most of the time his concentration was not on his lessons, but on propaganda. He was 14 years old. It was 1907, and our flat became a secret address for the revolutionaries. The party members used to meet there. Vladimir, despite his age, was on an equal footing with them."
When he was in the fifth form, he was expelled from school. From then on, it was one prison after another. He joined the Bolshevik Party as a propagandist, working amongst the shoemakers, bakers, printers. His code name was Comrade Constantine. On the 29th of March, 1908, the police laid an ambush and he was arrested. He had to eat his notebook because of secret addresses in it. He was released and worked for the party for a year. Then it was prison again. They took his gun away from him. Moscow Police Department, 1908. Mayakovsky Vladimir Vladimirovich was given the nickname Tall. Tall lives at Butigina's house. At precisely 11:20, he left home and went to the city along Nikolskaya Street. He stayed at a certain address for 35 minutes. Tall lives at... He stayed the night at... He had a meeting with... He was arrested for the third time. The last place he wanted to be was in prison, so he kicked up one hell of a fuss. They responded by transferring him from one prison to another. As prisoner number 103, he found himself at Butyrskaya in solitary confinement. He was there for 11 months, and it was a revealing time for Mayakovsky. After 3 years of theory and practice, he became interested in fiction again. He read all the new books. They were interesting, but he hadn't written them. The themes and ideas were not his. He tried writing himself. It was on a par with the work he'd been reading, but it really wasn't very good. He was grateful that they took it all away from him, because in the euphoria of finally being released, he might have published it. But now Mayakovsky had a more sensible attitude to life. He knew that he needed more experience, to attend a proper school and do some serious studying. He gave up his work for the party and settled down to prepare himself, spending a whole year just reading books. Then he got into art school. It was the only place he could go without papers. He progressed well and soon realized that the powers above approved of those who simply copied the works of others, whilst they condemned those who showed originality and independence. Mayakovsky's revolutionary instincts placed him firmly in the second category. A man called Burluk arrived at the school. As a poet, he had all the anger of a scholar who was way ahead of his contemporaries. Mayakovsky, on the other hand, had the enthusiasm of a socialist who believed passionately in the destruction of the old world. Russian Futurism was born. Korney Chukovsky, the famous Russian writer and poet, was to write in his memoirs, "My attitude to futurists was quite complex. I loathed their principle, at the same time I liked them and their talent. I hated them because they introduced into their poetry a sense of anarchy. At the same time, it had to be conceded that some of their poems were genuine works of art. Mayakovsky had already published some poems, and I considered him to be a cut above the rest. Beneath the pretext of his futurist images, I felt a real human sorrow, which was incompatible with his bombastic theatrical style." Mayakovsky never had the luxury of costumes. He only had two shirts, and very cheap ones at that. He used the traditional method of presenting himself, namely a tie, only he never had any money, so he used a piece of yellow ribbon instead. People were outraged. The company traveled extensively across Russia, lecturing, giving evening performances. The powers above were very nervous of them. In Nikolaev, they were cautioned not to mention Pushkin or the government. The police would often raid their performances. Publishers didn't want to know about them, and the capitalists thought they were a keg of dynamite. As a result of this experience, Mayakovsky wrote a tragedy called Vladimir Mayakovsky. It was staged in Luna Park in St. Petersburg, and it was a complete and utter failure. However, Korney Chukovsky wrote about the play. "In the winter of 1913, we watched Mayakovsky's tragedy, the author himself playing the leading role. The house was jam-packed. Everyone was anticipating something scandalous, and they were all waiting to demonstrate their indignation. Instead, they found themselves listening to the lyrical voice of a man full of sorrow, complaining bitterly of the cruelty and worthlessness of the life that surrounded him. It became clear that a brilliant new poet had appeared on the scene in Russia." In her memoirs, Gorky's wife, Maria Andreeva, was to write,
"In 1918, I saw Mayakovsky on the stage. In my opinion, he could be a great actor if he devoted himself to this profession."
It is 1914, the war. At first, Mayakovsky was excited, but then he only saw one side of it, the glory. Then came the first battle and the revelation that war was disgusting. Mayakovsky sensed that he was becoming a master of his art, being able to cover any topic, especially a revolutionary one. He was in the throes of writing his poem, A Cloud in Trousers. He went to Mustamiaki, met Maxim Gorky, and read to him the completed passages of the poem. Gorky was moved to tears and wept on Mayakovsky's shoulder, which made him feel very proud. Maxim Gorky's wife, Maria Andreeva, was to write in her memoirs,
"My husband admired Mayakovsky, although he was a bit concerned about the strident quality of his poetry. On one occasion he told Mayakovsky, 'Imagine you went out at dawn and started to shout as loudly as you could. Would you be able to keep that up all day?'
Mayakovsky published his poems, Spy and Flute and A Cloud in Trousers. There were lots of changes to the latter, the censors cutting it unmercifully. Cloud, in Mayakovsky's opinion, was a unification of contemporary art. To hell with your love, your art, your state system, and your religion. To accept or not to accept, there was no such question in the minds of Mayakovsky and his fellow Moscow futurists. This was his revolution. He went to Smolny and worked for the movement, doing everything he possibly could. I remember how impressed the workers were when they saw his play, Mystery Booth. They were fascinated by it, said Lunacharsky, Secretary of Education at the time. Civil war. Lenin said that everyone must mobilize, do everything to help the army. He added that it was essential that the workers ask themselves at each meeting how they could organize transport. Lenin further advocated that everyone should pull themselves together, watching closely what was going on, motivating the people up near the front line, and never forgetting the value of political propaganda. The artist, Chernich, wrote in his memoirs, "Our satirical posters were everywhere, on the streets, in the railway stations. There was plenty going on and we covered it all. When Mayakovsky joined us, he wrote all the legends, sometimes 80 a day. While we made placards for the first batch, he would finish off, then start to paint the posters alongside us. This was a new art form. It was born out of a time of suffering and created with slogans and pots of paint." What about futurism? They would cry out. The October Revolution had separated our group from the futurism that spurned revolutionary Russia and turned us into communist futurists. We called ourselves the LFA, and utilizing futurist methods in our artistic endeavors, we covered a whole range of social topics. Political newsletters, general propaganda, together with the industrial propaganda, was an advertisement for our cause. Despite any artistic disapproval, I believe the same advertisement contained poetry of a very high standard. From the painter Rodchenko's memoirs, Mayakovsky not only wrote the words for our posters, he painted the actual placards and slogans themselves. It was relaxing for him. He was at peace when he was doing this. Nikolai Asiev wrote of Mayakovsky, "He had great faith in his friends. He liked people who were not demanding in their friendship. He used to say that a true friend would never refuse you anything, even if he totally disagreed with what you were doing. Real friends do not quarrel with one another." One of Mayakovsky's closest friends was Lilia Yuryevna Brick, to whom he devoted many of his poems.
Короной кончу, святой Елены, буря жизни оседлав валы, я равный кандидат и на царя вселенной, и на кандалы. Быть царем назначено мне. Твое личико на солнечном золоте моих монет велю народу. Вычекань! А там, где тундрой мир выленил, где северным ветром ведет река торги, на цепь нацарапаю имя Лилина и цепь исцелую во мраке каторги. Звонок от ожогов уже визжит, добела раскален аппарат. Больна она лежит. Беги, скорей, пора. Может, может быть, когда-нибудь дорожка из зоологических аллей и она зверей любила, тоже вступит в сад, улыбаясь, вот такая, как на карточке на столе. Она красивая, ее, наверное, воскресят. Воскреси хотя бы за то, что я поэтом ждал тебя, откинув будничную чушь. Воскреси меня хотя бы за это. Воскреси, свое дожить хочу.
The writer Shklovsky was to write in his memoirs, "People were forever criticizing him, especially the communist authorities. They would try to point him in what they thought was the right direction. They would explain to him just what he should or should not do. They would tell him that he should not write about love. But Mayakovsky couldn't deposit his soul like one leaves a coat in the cloakroom. He wrote about simple things and found in that the seeds of revolution, which as often as not got him into more trouble." Komsomolskaya Pravda's correspondent, Rosenfeld, remembered, "Mayakovsky wrote in his time for 35 newspapers and 57 magazines. He took great pride in working for a newspaper as just an ordinary employee. Mayakovsky used to say that he was first and foremost a journalist, and whatever the consequences, spoke out as a journalist. He was very proud of working to a deadline and having to rush an urgent article into print." On reading one of Mayakovsky's political poems in Izvestia, Lenin said, "I am not an admirer of Mayakovsky, but then I am not an expert in that field. But I do want to say that I enjoyed the poem very much from a political standpoint." In his poem, he mocked indecisive meetings, making fun of the communists for organizing such events. I can't judge his poetry, but from a political point of view, he was right. Lenin more than approved of Mayakovsky's outspoken support for the revolution and was delighted that such a famous writer was helping the cause with so much useful propaganda. From the memoirs of party activist Malkin, I shall never forget Mayakovsky reading his poem Vladimir Ilyich Lenin in the Bolshoi Theater on the anniversary of his death. The audience was captivated, and when he finished, they burst into thunderous applause. Mayakovsky went abroad. He wanted to have a look at Western art. At the beginning of his trip, he was to write his last full poem. The writer Lydia Sefulina wrote in her memoirs,
Mayakovsky's admirers took over the Café Voltaire for the whole evening on his arrival in Paris. After his performance, Mayakovsky left the café surrounded by such an excitable crowd of well-wishers that the mounted guard was forced to move back. This demonstration of affection in Paris was a carbon copy of the one I had witnessed in Moscow.
He traveled all over the world. Mexico, the United States, various parts of France, and Spain. As a result, he wrote a lot of fiction, My Discovery of America, and some verses. But his trip around the world was a failure. He was robbed in Paris, and after 6 months, he couldn't wait to get back to Russia. But back in his homeland, he was to become disillusioned. All his life he had been a staunch communist, but now he was having doubts. Not about the theory, he had always believed in that. Communism was still his religion. It was the hierarchy that concerned him. He had always supported the party and could not suddenly openly rebel against his ideals. Nevertheless, he was beginning to see people being turned into machines. The poet Asiev remembers, there were many aspects of Mayakovsky's behavior that we couldn't comprehend. What we didn't understand was that sometimes he was very unhappy. People accused him, saying that workers could not understand his poetry. When asked why, he kept silent in response to these accusations. Mayakovsky replied, I have no right to fight. And then added, if I begin to fight, I'll kill. He did kill. At the age of 37, he killed himself. People from all walks of life, who were not interested in ridiculous arguments about literature, stood in line at his coffin, spontaneously recognizing the strangeness of his life and his death. These people did not believe he had really taken his own life. They still don't believe it.